As we continue this week to reflect on important elements of Jesus, it's my delight today to remind us of something we can often forget. We've seen that Jesus is gentle and humble of heart. He is compassionate and sympathetic. Jesus is joyful and steadfast. And today we want to remember that he remains active in expressing all of this. I teach the Bible at Ridley College, and students study at a range of levels. We have an introductory certificate for people new to formally studying the Bible. There are diplomas and degrees at university level. If you've already got some university experience, you might undertake a graduate certificate or another graduate degree. And if you study hard enough, you can even work right through to a doctorate. One of our teachers walked into one of the very advanced classes one day and asked a very simple question. What is Jesus doing right now? Here was a classroom of capable students, most of whom attended sensible churches and who had been studying for several years by this point. What is Jesus doing right now? Most of the class was silent. Perhaps the common thought running through their minds was that Jesus is seated at the right hand of the Father Almighty and is waiting to be sent back at the second coming. In effect, that class thought what many of us might think today, that Jesus is basically twiddling his thumbs and doing nothing much else in the meantime. I wasn't in that class, but I suspect my answer would have been very similar. That's because I hadn't yet read and understood the chapter we're looking at today. Hebrews 7 answers the question, and its answer is one of the most encouraging things I've ever learned. I wonder if you're ever unsure what to say. There are certainly times when I'm too shy to talk much. There are other times when I might not know the language or the local custom. Sometimes I'm too confused or distressed to find coherent words. When I lived in the Middle East, it was important to keep your paperwork up to date. When it came time to renew your visa, you had to go to the Central Administration Building. This building had 14 stories. There could be at least 20,000 civil servants working there each day, and not many of them spoke very good English. The visit should have been as scary as it looks. Perhaps you've had a similar experience either overseas or even here in Australia. But I had a wonderful advantage, a saviour, if you will. My wife and I knew a senior Australian who had lived in the city for years. He spoke Arabic, he knew which floor we needed to visit, whom to see, and what to say. I'm sure we were there in that building for only 20 or 30 minutes, even though the tourist guidebooks make it clear that you might expect to spend several hours lost in this concrete maze. Lots of different cultures have this kind of facilitator or intermediary, that special person with all the connections who can make things happen. You might have such a person in your life. When you plan travel, it can be easier to leave all your administration with a travel agent. If you're organising a wedding, you can hire a wedding consultant to help choose the dress and book the venue, arrange the photographer, contact the florist, and so on. Perhaps you might have enjoyed upmarket accommodation, staying in a hotel where a concierge is on hand to arrange your every need. Or perhaps you're used to a simpler family lifestyle where one or other of your relatives knows someone who can just get the job done. Hebrews 7 tells us that Jesus has this kind of role for Christians. Jesus serves as that special contact who knows how to get things done. Jesus knows the right people to speak with, the right words to say, even when we don't. The Bible calls such a person a priest. In the Old Testament, you needed a priest to help you to worship God properly. The priest would teach you the right way to live and to please God. The priest would instruct you about the kinds of sacrifices you needed to bring. You'd then bring your sacrifice to the priest, and the priest would offer it on the altar on your behalf. And then the priest would assure you of God's forgiveness and send you off with a blessing on God's behalf. The priest was the man who knew how to get things done, especially when it came to encountering God properly. When I've used these kinds of ideas in the youth program at my church, some enthusiastic teenagers quickly celebrate, "Isn't it great that God no longer requires this?" Well, that claim is partly true, but it's also partly mistaken. Hebrews 7 helps us to unpack this further, and it reminds us of some of the special work of Jesus, and especially of what Jesus is doing now. The letter to the Hebrews often makes contrasts between the Old Testament and the New Testament. The original readers already understood the Old Testament, and they thought it was pretty good. So the author of this letter writes to them that everything done well in the Old Testament is now done even better by Jesus. Here in chapter 7, the contrast is between the priests of the Old Testament and the priesthood of Jesus in the New Testament. Hebrews agrees that the priests of the Old Testament were the people who could help the Israelites to worship God properly. In fact, the priests were God's idea in the first place. It was God who commissioned priests to aid the people to worship him. But Hebrews also wants to remind us that God has upgraded this idea, and now in the New Testament, God has commissioned Jesus as the best priest to aid the people to worship God. The first paragraph in today's reading describes those Old Testament priests. We hear lots of Old Testament names. The priests were chosen from the tribe of Levi, which is why they're often called the Levitical priesthood and why the book of Leviticus is all about correct tabernacle worship. From within that tribe of Levi, the priests come from the particular family of Aaron. Aaron was the brother of Moses, and as the head of his family, Aaron was the high priest of all the Israelites. But Hebrews highlights for us two particular weaknesses with these Old Testament priests. First, those human priests were just as frail and sinful as the other Israelites. So an Old Testament priest had to spend part of his time offering sacrifices for his own sins before he could help others to worship God properly. Second, those frail human priests kept dying just like anyone else. So new priests had to keep being trained up. God knew that these Old Testament priests were just a temporary measure. It's a bit like learning to ride a bicycle. You start slowly with some training wheels until you learn to gain your balance. Or perhaps it's like when we're first learning to drive. Our parents give us the older, battered car first. It's only once we know more about driving that they trust us with the better model. Through the Old Testament, God is training his people to understand the importance of priests when it comes to approaching God for worship. And through the Old Testament, we keep seeing hints that God is planning to trust his people with an even better priest. Hebrews unpacks God's priestly plans in great detail, but today I want to point out two highlights from our chapter. If you're following along in your own Bible, I'm going to start with the last paragraph and work backwards. The last paragraph points out one of those two particular weaknesses of Old Testament priests. Such a high priest, meaning Jesus, truly meets our need, one who is holy, blameless, pure, set apart from sinners, exalted above the heavens. Unlike those other high priests, Jesus does not need to offer sacrifices day after day, first for his own sins and then for the sins of the people. Jesus sacrificed for their sins once for all time when he offered himself. This is why our Anglican Communion service celebrates the one perfect and sufficient sacrifice of Jesus. We heard a few weeks ago from Hebrews chapter 4 that Jesus is a sympathetic high priest. He has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet he did not sin. And here in chapter 7, his lack of sin is one of the things that makes him more effective than the Old Testament priests. Then the previous paragraph here also addresses the other imperfection with the Old Testament priests. Now, there have been many of those Old Testament priests since death prevented them from continuing in office. But because Jesus lives forever, he has a permanent priesthood. Therefore, he is able to save completely those who come to God through him, because he always lives to intercede for them. God's Old Testament priesthood was a gracious gift to his people because it helped them to approach God to worship him properly. But God's New Testament priesthood in Jesus is even more gracious. Jesus was and is sinless, so he can focus his full attention on helping us to approach God to worship him. And Jesus lives forever, so all Christians in all generations throughout their lives can meet Jesus and keep relying on him to introduce us to God. And there is the answer to our classroom question. What is Jesus doing right now? He is seated at the right hand of the Father Almighty, and he is introducing people to God to aid them to worship God properly. Of course, Jesus introduces us to God the first time we come to him, but Jesus reintroduces us each time we come before God. You and I know how we each persistently fall short of God's glory. Yet each time we come back to God, Jesus again acknowledges to God that Jesus' sacrifice is sufficient. And Jesus also assures us that his sacrifice is sufficient and that we are welcome in God's throne room. This is what verse 25 means when it says that Jesus always lives to intercede for us. If you're worried that something you've done this week can never be forgiven, Jesus always lives to intercede for us, to assure God and to assure us of forgiveness. If you've been harboring some big sin for many months or many years, then Hebrews 7 assures us that you can approach God through Jesus, because Jesus always lives to intercede for us. This is the interceding heart of Jesus. Jesus is gentle and humble of heart. He is compassionate and sympathetic. He is joyful and steadfast. So, like a good friend who introduces us to all the right people, like the relative who has all the right connections, Jesus is ready and willing and able to intercede for us before God. We need Jesus when we do know what to say to God, when we need to come and apologize and to plead yet again for forgiveness. And we need Jesus when we don't know what to say to God. We read elsewhere in the Bible, especially in Romans chapter 8, again that Jesus intercedes for us. That same chapter assures us that the Holy Spirit intercedes as well, even when the best that we can muster is a wordless groan. On those days when I'm too shy to talk to God, Jesus always lives to intercede for me and to reintroduce me to God. At those times when I'm too confused or distressed to string words together to pray to God, Jesus always lives to intercede for me, and however uncertain or disoriented I might feel, to point me in God's direction. When suffering and persecution, temptation and doubt come like a flood and threaten to overwhelm me, when everything around me seems about to collapse and all I can muster in prayer is a timid shriek of help, the interceding heart of Jesus is awake and alert. Hebrews 4 invites us to hold on tight and to come to the throne with confidence. And Hebrews 7 assures us of why we can have such confidence. Jesus always lives, even today, to intercede for us as we come to God through him. Amen.